Well, the Dyess colony showed a great initiative on the part of the federal and state government, especially at implementing progressive programs. It did not, however, effectively address and or solve the problems facing Arkansans at the time, such as the need to create new trades outside of farming and make an infrastructure that could mesh well with the increasing industrialization of the country. In April of 1927, Arkansas saw record rainfall, with more than 7 inches falling on Little Rock in just a few hours. There was no place for it to go because the ground was already saturated. Lakes, rivers, and stream beds were full. The Mississippi River backed up into the Arkansas, White, and St. Francis Rivers. The White River even ran backward at one point as torrents rushed into it from the Mississippi. Homes and stores stood for months in 6 to 30 feet of murky water. Dead animals floated everywhere. Rich Arkansas farmland was covered with sand, coated in mud, or simply washed away, still bearing the shoots from spring planting. The Great Flood of 1927 was the most destructive in state history. More than 6,000 square miles of farmland were inundated, and 350,000 people were displaced. Many independent farmers were unable to recover and lost their land, and thus had to transition to tenant farming. Additional floods, along with forest fires, droughts, and tornadoes, plagued Arkansas well into the early 1930s. The flood of 1927 took place when the rest of the country was enjoying the peak of the Roaring Twenties. In Washington, D.C., the federal response under President Calvin Coolidge was simple. Not $1 of federal money went in direct aid to the flood victims. By 1929, Arkansas led the nation in per capita debt, and the state legislature ceased funding for public construction, such as for schools and roads. The stock market crash also exacerbated Arkansas' fiscal problems. By 1930, Arkansas's labor force was 80% agricultural, the majority being poor tenant farmers. Arkansas's per capita income was less than half the national average of $705. Between the times of 1929 to 1932, more than a third of employed Arkansans had lost their jobs. In many ways, Arkansas experienced the hardship of the Great Depression of the 1930s, even before the stock market crash of 1929. It led the nation in per capita indebtedness. It had low crop prices, which hurt the farmers in the areas and made it nearly impossible for current tenant farmers to survive. Schools and roads were deteriorating, which further helped to isolate the state from the rest of the country. In 1933, Franklin D. Roosevelt took office as president. Acting swiftly to stabilize the economy and provide jobs and relief to those who were suffering, the New Deal was born. A series of programs and projects instituted during the Great Depression by Franklin Roosevelt that aimed to restore prosperity to Americans. Over the next 8 years, the government instituted a series of experimental New Deal projects and programs. Programs such as the Civilian Conservation Corps, or CCC, which allowed single men between the ages of 18 and 25 to enlist in work programs to improve America's public lands, forests, and parks. They also fought forest fires, planted trees, cleared and maintained access roads, reseeded grazing lands, and implemented soil erosion controls. Works Progress Administration, or WPA, was also implemented to help build up the nation's public infrastructure. With the creation of roads, parks, schools, and other public buildings, and between the years of 1935 and 1943, the WPA employed 8.5 million people. The Tennessee Valley Authority, or TVA, provided jobs and electricity to the rural Tennessee River Valley, an area that spans 7 states in the South. The Securities and Exchange Commission, or SEC, was created to help avoid exacerbating the already devastating economic effects of the Great Depression, and to also try and prevent any future market calamities from happening. An important reason that Arkansas got a fair share of the New Deal programs was due in large part to 2 Arkansas state senators, Hattie Wyatt Carraway and Joseph Taylor Robinson. Both were strong supporters of the New Deal program and worked to bring relief programs to Arkansas. The CCC put more than 200,000 Arkansas men to work across the nation, paying them decent wages and helping to improve their overall health by providing decent meals. The National Youth Administration, or NYA, enlisted young women and men between the ages of 16 and 25 in various programs such as construction projects for the young men and service projects, homemaking and craft projects for young women, teaching many young Arkansans valuable new trade skills. Arkansas NYA projects included construction or repair of school facilities such as shop buildings, vocational agricultural structures, home economics cottages, and gymnasiums. The WPA employed rural laborers in building bridges, courthouses, dams, farm-to-market roads, parks, and rural schools, and recreational facilities such as bandshells and swimming pools. The Dyess Colony, the brainchild of the young director of the State Emergency Relief Administration, William Reynolds Dyess. As the Depression wore on, Dyess became enthralled with the possibility of rehabilitating unemployed men and their families on small subsistence farms. Since the New Deal was already moving in that direction, he had no difficulty selling his plan for the colony to the Federal Relief Administrator, Harry L. Hopkins, and obtaining the necessary funds of over $3 million. Dyess, a Mississippi County plantation owner, was Arkansas's first WPA administrator, and had a hope that in this colony, tenant farmers would have a chance to own their own land by cultivating their own land plots. With the help of his second-in-command, Robert H. McNair, and through the use of Federal Emergency Relief Administration, or FERA, Dyess would purchase 16,000 acres of uncleared bottom land in Mississippi County, which was rich and fertile and would make good farmland for the new colonists. The land Dyess had purchased was swampy and jungle-like, with trees of all kinds including cottonwood, ash, hickory, scrub oak, and cypress. The trees and vines that were there created an almost impassable fortress and were infested with venomous snakes. Construction began at the new colony, initially known as Colonization Project No. 1. Well before it was ready for the farm colonists, the colony was providing jobs for hundreds of unemployed Arkansas residents during its construction. Approximately 1,300 laborers were needed, all hired from the state relief programs. While some workers lived nearby and were able to commute to work, others had to live at the site in an army-style camp with barracks, kitchen, and dining hall, as well as sawmills and other infrastructure needed to perform their daily duties. The majority of the timber used for the construction of colony buildings came from the land itself, being cut and harvested by the workers and processed with on-site sawmills. Federal aid would help create this new utopia for farmers and homesteading families as a resettlement colony and help them create new lives within. Nearly 500 impoverished Arkansas farm families, including the family of music legend Johnny Cash, would arrive at the Dyess colony, and each of these new farmers would have 20 acres of land for cultivation. The Dyess colony was created in 1934 as part of President Franklin D. Roosevelt's New Deal, and was the largest colony of its kind, and sought to aid in the nation's economic recovery from the Great Depression. As a federal agricultural resettlement community, it provided a fresh start for many and contained a hospital, school, churches, commissary, canning plant, and administration building. Dyess quickly became one of the most famous resettlement colonies for impoverished farmers during the Great Depression, gaining its official name in memory of the late William Dyess, that had passed away in a horrific plane crash along with his finance director Robert McNair. Leadership being handed to Dyess' longtime friend, Floyd Sharp. Several weeks after the official dedication, First Lady Eleanor Roosevelt visited Dyess. The development of Dyess' colony was considered by some to be nothing more than a romantic vision of rugged pioneer families engaged in carving their own homes out of the wilderness, and that it was a back-to-the-land scheme, an attempt to create a more traditional and rural lifestyle for Arkansas farmers. Like most New Deal housing projects, it was intended for white people only, which occurred all too often in the New Deal's housing and recolonization projects, with segregation plaguing the good intentions of the New Deal programs. Despite it being a segregated colony, it was also quite discriminatory to even other white Southerners, and it only allowed certain people to live in the colony. People who hailed from the lowest poverty level, who had adequate physical abilities to plow the land, and those with having a good moral background. Farmers in the community were given an advance to help start up their farms. However, they were expected to pay back this advance. This meant that the settlement was essentially a risky investment for many. In 1939, it became a battleground for Overseer Sharp and his political rival, Governor Carl Bailey. Through time, it became a symbol for a bygone era of white supremacy. The white columned administration building, which resembles a southern plantation house, became a symbol and focal point of controversy in 1940 when the colony was placed under the management of the Farm Security Administration. While little better than tenant farming, most farmers were not literate enough to understand the contracts they were getting into, which caused many to become financially trapped in the colony and no better off than when they first arrived. The realities of rural America in the 1930s made the success of any back-to-the-land scheme a gamble at best, and Dyess' colony encountered other problems which diverted it from its main objective. It proved to be impossible to sustain the agrarian idealism characteristic of early Depression years. It was used to its detriment as a subject of controversy between two political rivals. While Dyess' colony was only a small, perhaps unique case in federal-state relations of the New Deal era, it clearly suggests the handicaps under which New Dealers had to operate and the changes of federal programs after they were absorbed into the fabric of local societies.